To please start with his presentation.
Yes, thank you so much, sir, and I am obliged, and I am very happy that I am able to share my on this platform my knowledge. So a very happy Doctor's Day, first of all, starting with the presentation. So the myself, Dr. Anurag, as Nilima has introduced very rightly. So seeing the image, cystic dilemma starts from inter consultant surgeons, physicians, so on so forth. So many of them might think the slabs may be three, many might be thinking slabs may be four. So how to deal with the diagnostic dilemma? To deal with the diagnostic dilemma, we have today's topic. What I would like to share my knowledge of interest is 3D imaging in maxillofacial trauma. The time is now. So to reveal this, some might be thinking that there are three slabs. They might be a poor slab. So another point of complex diagnostic, another point of complex diagnosis occur, which may occur in day-to-day clinical practice is the way we think in that, like some may think it is a six, some may think it is nine. From their point of view, from everyone's point of view, we think that we are right. So to reveal that diagnostic dilemma again, I would like to introduce the game changer for humankind, Sir William Conrad Roentgen, who invented the X-rays on 8 November 1895. So, which has altered and innovated and changed the face of our medical fraternity again, with respect to diagnosis, respect to therapeutic uses. So this is the day of our radiology starts. So these are when we do everything, what our routine starts. So coming to the topic per se, I would like to share my presentation under these following topics. First will be the introduction, then the type of maxillofacial traumatic injuries of the heart tissue, imaging modalities, direct and indirect radiographic signs for fractures, and evaluation of few cases which I underwent during my post-graduation days till date. Okay, so coming to the introduction, maxillofacial injuries are occurring in increasing rate due to rapid lifestyle and speedy mode of transportation. Okay, so to the radiologic examination is always important, because it determines the presence, location, and orientation of the fracture lines, fragments. Okay, then the standard radiographic projections are usually essential for essentially the first step in diagnosing. Okay, and it still provide the foundation for imaging maxillofacial trauma. So it is because of the intricate anatomy of the maxillofacial region, it is difficult to obtain the standard good quality images. Okay, and this becomes altogether more problematic to the injured patients again. So the basic rule for maxillofacial imaging always states that the radiograph should always be imaged along both the long axis of the patient, so that appropriate diagnosis and then appropriate accurate treatment can be carried out. Okay, so radiographs are the foundation of imaging for simple trauma, but for complex traumatic cases, it should be complemented by advanced imaging scans, okay, which we are sharing today. So CT scan is considered currently to be the gold standard in the three-dimensional diagnosis, because it gives the special relationship of soft as well as the heart tissue being evaluated in the three windows, what we call it as. Okay, so then there is an increasing demand for three-dimensional imaging, which has increased the clinicians to develop again more compact low dose devices, because CT, once it shoots, the radiation exposure goes in 500 or 2000 microsievert again. So to overcome this limitation, for heart tissue imaging, the low dose compact devices like CBCT, which was introduced in 1997, okay, and which produces similar three-dimensional images but at the lowest radiation cost, and also the lower cost for imaging can be done by using CBCT. So the present day lecture, I would like to share this preoperative imagology using advanced imaging technique, whether it is indicated or not, and then which will be helpful for operating surgeons for diagnosis and accurate treatment. Then why we require 3D? What is the significance of 3D? 3D there is a visualization of the manifested disease, deformation, and malocclusion, which gets diagnosed accurately. Okay, within the millimeters of the range, we can diagnostic accuracy of the particular imaging is there. Then better for better understanding or diagnosing the particular case. Okay, so that we can then after understanding or diagnosing the case, you can do that point up to the point treatment of 3D planning by using that in-depth knowledge of the particular pathology. Here today we'll discuss about the maxillofacial trauma. Then this is a pictorial graphical presentation. I would like to share 2D versus 3D. So 2D imaging, so when we compile the letters A, B, C and D and keep it in one over other, that is superimposition, can be seen very clearly. So this is two-dimensional image what we see in the maxillofacial region. So what volume rendering three-dimensional imaging does, it particularly takes out the scans and particular sections at a particular level. Okay, so when we see this, we can take out the particular section in a exactly accurately where the orientation line and extent of the fracture line is there. So another self-explanatory three-dimensional imaging image. So what is the significance of image? Three-dimensional imaging can be evaluated in this image. So sliced, when we slice it out, we see the particular level or image or level of the particular fracture line, extent of the fracture line, segment, fragment, so on and so forth. So the right side of the image where my cursor is, the apple seems to be completely, this is nothing but a pictorial presentation of three-dimensional scans which can be used for anfacial trauma, mid-face fractures, orbital fracture also, so on and so forth for gross anatomy. But when we sliced it, we see the particular axial sections which we are covering in the next slides again. Okay, so we take the slices of particular image. So before starting with the particular indications and all and imagology of particular pathology or the traumatic injuries, so the radiologist gives the patient selection criteria what according to us must be, and nowadays it is very important because the e-licensing companies and AERB has become very strict. They had kept very strict norms with respect to these principles. So LRA principle, as low as reasonably achievable principle, which must be followed. Okay, whenever you indicate any patient for the imaging. But now it has been not altered, I will say, it has been changed to the ALADA, LADA. It is nothing but as low as diagnostically achievable imaging modality is evaluated. Okay. So there should be justification of exposures to the patient so that total diagnostic benefits, so risk versus benefit factor is always one scans. So it should be used only when periapical or conventional OPG or PNS, PA, radiograph are necessary, do not give any necessary information for diagnosis and treatment planning. But if they are sufficing, you should avoid or you should keep in mind about referring the patient to the three-dimensional scans. So these are the basic imaging modalities, but today our image, like plain film, IOPA, which forms the backbone of the dentistry, which is the basic radiograph. For maxillofacial complex, I have divided the radiographs into these particular scans, particular slide, and then for mandibular fracture, we can be evaluated by these conventional radiographs. Now today's topic, in depth, I will give the knowledge about three-dimensional and recent advancement in reconstruction images of facial trauma, which is evaluated by the CT scan, which gives 1.5 to 3 millimeter cuts in all the planes. So the planes we will discuss again, how we evaluate as a radiologist, we evaluate the sections. So MRI, which can be only used for soft tissue injuries, the USG also for superficial fractures can also be used. The studies have indicated the 2002 or 2008 and 9 years, we have got studies for USG again for evaluating. Now CBCT, what I would be like again talking in depth, which is more helpful, which was since 1997, it has revolutionized the dental radiology again. So these are the basic direct radiographic signs of the fracture. Most of the oral surgeons might be well versed with this. So abnormal linear density, again overlapping sign fragment, disappearing fragment, again step deformity, the discontinuity of the bone can be seen, displaced bone and widened medial ligament in dentolateral fractures. So I will not go into that depth again. So indirect radiographic signs like soft tissue impingement, soft tissue encroachment, soft tissue falling down into the particular anatomic structure, which includes the soft tissue swelling, can be highlighted because some fluid filled structures can be evaluated by the radiograph, like parenchymal sinus opacification, air in soft tissue emphysema, and intraorbital air can also be evaluated because these cavities are very lucent, they are highlighted as a part of the opacity. That's why I am talking in terms of that opacification, which is highlighted into the lucent structure. So this is again more 4S signs of Del Balso et al. The symmetry, that is loss of symmetry of the structures when you evaluate the whenever you evaluate any CT MRI or CBCT, loss of symmetry is there in the traumatic any lesion. The alteration in the sharpness of the structure, the sinus, when the sinus three walls, I will just go and discuss with respect to the patients very beautifully. It gives a particular sinus pathology, and fractures of the sinus can be evaluated very nicely, and a soft tissue encroachment like orbital tissue flat fat can be encroaching into the floor of the sinus. So basic classification, I will not go again that deep into that because it is not my domain. For the treatment modalities, the oral surgeons are best out of it. So basically, when we classify fractures, maxillofacial complex fractures and mandibular fractures, and maxillofacial again include the panfacial trauma, orbital, ethmoidal, etc., subdivisions of that. With respect to the treatment modality, we have favorable and unfavorable fractures. So coming to the first and foremost, which is the was the gold standard and still will remain in some cases for the gold standard, is the computed tomographic scans. So it is the greatest invention and innovation of the radiology field, which has changed the medical field completely. Okay, so it gives a better insight to the into the pathogenesis of the body for any lesions, and it because of that you can diagnose accurately, and then the chances of recovery of the patient for the after the treatment will be very beautiful and very nice. So this is the magic of the three-dimensional imaging, what you call it. Then in 1979, the Godfrey Armfield and A.M. Cormack, who invented the CT, was awarded with the Nobel Prize. This is about the history of this CT. So it is one of the most important method in radiological diagnosis in advanced imaging aid. Okay, so it delivers non-superimposed or clean images without any superimposition of the particular pathology. It also allows the better visualization of specific different structured soft tissue, hard tissue and intermediate tissue, both which highlights the images highlights both soft as well as the hard tissue. So these are the basic radiation exposures I have taken from one of the references, Cohen et al, who evaluated the radiation exposure doses of particular in milligrays. So conventional lithography, but obviously it is very less. CBCT or DVT, it is 4.2 milligray average dose of the particular individual, and dental CT, it is 23 milligray. So when you convert this into millisieverts, the CT scan dose comes almost 800 to 1000 microsievert or millisievert, whereas which is 50% of that of the particular CT scan, we have CBCT doses. So what lies beneath? Basically, when we evaluate the CT scan very precisely, there is some point of time we have 3D scans, we have multiplanar reconstruction images. So these are the basic reference plane which we use. Because CBCT images and reference plane are similar to that of the CT, I will not go detail in different planes. Okay, but basic planes what we see is axial, sagittal, coronal, and transaxial, also called as multiplanar reconstruction images. So when axial image, when we see, it goes along the long axis. The sections are taken along the long axis of the teeth. Okay, so you can see in this image there is a maxilla. There are the my cursor is there over the maxilla. My cursor is over the condyle, the ramus, and the condyle. So this is the axial image or the transfer image we see along the long axis. The coronal section, what we talk about, is nothing but the frontal profile of the patient. So you can see the orbit, you can see the sinus, you can see the nasal septum, turbinates, the nasal cavity, the floor of nose, the sinus, and the palate, and the maxillary teeth, mandibular teeth, and the mandible. So this is the frontal image you can evaluate for this. The sagittal section is nothing but the lateral profile, what we see in the lateral radiographs, etc., so on and so forth. You can see the ethmoidal sinuses, you can see the frontal sinus, you can see the nasal septum, nasal bone, palate, lateral section of the anterior teeth, mandibular anterior teeth. Okay, so there are series of cross section also called as multiplanar reconstruction. Why it is called as multiplanar reconstruction images? Because it has a multiple plane. It includes axial, sagittal and coronal section in the same radiograph. So another image, beautiful images what we can see on the screen is the there is a nerve mapping. When you see the mandibular fracture, when the nerve is mandibular canal nerve, whether it is the canal is involved or not, whether nerve is involved, impinged, or destructed or fractured because of the fracture fragment. You can map the nerve very precisely and very clearly. So this one I was talking about the multiplanar reconstruction images. So it has an axial image. My cursor is here. It has a axial image. It has a sagittal section in the form of OPG, reference panoramic radiogram. It has a cut sections or the coronal sections. So these three things we have only in one. So multiplanar reconstruction images. When we talk about these sections, we always talk about multiplanar. So the radiology language must be universal, or any medicine language must be universal. That's why in the next slides onwards, I will be dealing with the sections, axial, sagittal, and coronal sections only. We will not talk about the frontal plane, axial plane, or sagittal plane. Okay. So, imaging maxillofacial fractures. This is the diagrammatic representation of report 1, 2, and 3. In short, I will be dealing with this. And multiple fracture, panfacial. Again, the graphical presentation of the ZM complex fracture. So, why maxillary region? Very beautifully explained by this slide. The pathology which is masked up, which can be masked up by the midface, can be evaluated very. Pathology which can be masked up in the midface region can be very well precisely imaged and sliced by the three-dimensional advanced imaging. So this is a 3D imaging, and I am obliged and feeling courtesy for my center to be providing me with the images of the patient without disclosing their identity. So this is the computed tomography coronal section. So the frontal profile again, coronal section. You can see Hello. So this is a coronal section. You can see the Del Balzo sign of symmetry. When you talk about in that, the symmetry is lost and there is a breach in the continuity of the particular right side. The arrow indicates that on the right image. Okay. So then next in the left image, you can see the fracture of the orbital floor as well as the sinus roof. You can see the fat of the orbit engorging into the sinus. So that is the soft tissue sign in the CT scan is very nicely evaluated. So this is the magic. Magic means it's a boon for us to evaluate the structures into the facial, into the maxillofacial imaging. Not only this, but this patient, these are all the patients which I have gathered through my this 10 years of my practice of imaging, right from my post-graduation. These are the real patients which I have presented in many conferences and my department again. Okay. So this is the patient with zygomaticomaxillofacial complex fracture, ZM complex, what we call it as. So coronal section, you can see the fracture lines, you can see the alteration into the anatomy of the sinus. And in the axial image, you can see the anterolateral wall of the sinus. Anterolateral wall of the sinus, you can see 1, 2, and 3 marking has been given by the radiologist. And the anterolateral wall, strip posterior lateral wall, can be seen. Excuse me. Sorry for the interruption. The AC has become very cool. Started affecting my voice. So sorry for the interruption. So in this ZM complex fracture, you can see the coronal section. Okay. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, Anurag. Yes, sir.
Sorry for interruption, sir. So ZM complex fracture, you can see the discontinuity of the anterolateral wall of the sinus, posterior lateral wall of the sinus, and sometimes when the panfacial trauma affects or lift foot are there, you can see the discontinuity in the medial wall of the sinus again. So you can compare 1 and 2, both the sinus you can compare, and you can see the evaluation of the fracture lines in the axial plane and the coronal section. So coming to the panfacial trauma also, when we have a three-dimensional scans, you can see how the patients with this panfacial trauma having the frontal bone fracture, having the parietal bone, temporal bone fracture, and a zygomatic fracture, which is comminuted one. So how precisely the images are there without any superimposition. This is nothing but a three-dimensional scan. Okay. Then next is the three-dimensional scan with reconstruction. So you can see how precisely the leaf foot 1-2, leaf foot 2 fractures, the ZM complex in the right image can be evaluated without any superimposition. And before giving the incision and opening that, reducing it with open reduction, you can see very precisely the number of fragments, orientation of fracture planes and depth or depressed or the elevated fracture are there. Okay, so this is again the CT scan I have taken from one of the patients. The pan fissure injury, at least one fracture in all the fissure thirds is usually seen. So I just come across that sir has told me that this was the trauma month for there. So pan fissure trauma lecture has already been covered by Lambadi sir. So this is a 3D imaging scan for pan fissure trauma. You can see how precisely the 3D imaging without superimposition is helpful in evaluating the fractures in the frontal bone, midface fracture, as well as the mandibular symphysial fracture. So with respect to this maxillofacial, there are some points in, with respect to the mandibular fracture. So basic classification we follow everywhere is, most of the time we follow, is with respect to the anatomical location. So why CT and how CT and how it is helpful in mandibular fractures. So this is the patient, this was the patient reported to us in my PG days. So it reported with the trauma injury, and you can see the right side of the fracture angle, the mandible. You can see the arrow. I have specifically indicated the arrow at a particular fracture site. You can see the angle fracture. This is the CT scan. Okay. Then the boon for us is that the vertical condylar fracture, which is usually superimposed in both the plane radiography when we evaluate both the plane radiographs. This is very precisely and clearly without any superimposition can be seen in the coronal plane. Okay, so I hope everybody can appreciate the fracture condyle, the alteration into the comminuted fracture. Okay, so not only this, the coronoid fracture, sometimes the symptoms may be pain, maybe only the pain in patient, but we cannot evaluate in the conventional radiograph. Okay, so the CT has that bone that you can see even the coronoid bone fracture, coronoid bone fracture of the mandible. So in this image, we have evaluated that patient was having a coronoid bone fracture again. You can see breach in the continuity of the bone here. So with respect to the three-dimensional mandibular fracture, you can see how the fracture lines, the angular fracture line from symphysis to parasymphysial CL region is going, and the angular fracture of the patient. So bucket angle fracture, one more point I would like to add is like the fracture into the edentulous patient. Okay, you can see the 3D image of the particular patient, and that with we have to just scroll the image when we see on the screen, and while scrolling upside down, it becomes the fracture can be visualized from the inferior plane, that is axial plane. Again, this is again the three-dimensional reconstruction. So that was about the computed tomography and how it is helpful in diagnosing the maxillofacial traumatic injuries. So coming to the cone beam CT, which is the recent update, and the time is now for that. I have kept my title for this, is the time is now to recently update, and we have to update day by day. Okay, not by months to months, but we have to upgrade ourselves day by day. So cone beam computed tomography, also called as CBCT, DPT, CBVT. So digital volume tomography is another variant. So what is the difference? Many of the surgeons and physicians had asked me about this cone beam computed tomography and digital volume tomography. What is the difference basically? So cone beam computed tomography, it gives the complete area of the particular structure. For example, when we talk about the skull, we shoot the skull with the CBCT. It gives the complete orbit from head to the mandibular margins. But when we talk about the digital volume tomography, it gives the volume of a particular area of the skull. This is the best example I can give to my juniors and my colleagues, or even my seniors, when we discuss about the cases at my centers. Okay, so coming to the history again, it has first introduced in the European market in 1996 about the cone beam computed tomography. So Takino and Mozo and Godi, etc., had received again Nobel Prize in 2013. So this was again highlighted in the JADA. So in with respect to the protocols of the radiation dose range, it ranged from 1.09 milligrams to 6.1 with a particular software, and again MARS software, like we can evaluate, and the effective dose can be lowered. But already it is 60 to 70% low dose as compared to the CT scan. And then the effective dose, which was the CBCT and low dose of CT, they have compared, the authors compared. And then they have concluded that it is nothing, it is the alternative to low dose CT in this technique. So basically, when this, when in this image, which shows the difference between the CT scan and the cone beam CT. Why the name has, so everybody is familiar with the Japanese fan. Okay, so the fan beam CT is the what computed tomography or CT scan which is available in the market in various centers. So the beam is attenuated in the shape of the fan, so that you get a fan beam CT in the CT scan from the detector, and then it falls on the detector. Whereas in the cone beam CT, the X-ray are attenuated from the source in the shape of the cone. The base is seen on the detector. This is the detector, and the apex is on the source, which is attenuated. Not talking about deep in depth in the technical things, this is the basic difference between this conventional CT and a cone beam. So fan beam CT, the beam shape of the beam, the detector of conventional CT is single detector and rotation also single slice. For every slice you can have single rotation, again also called as spiral CT. So the rotation goes on spiral, in the spiral shape, and multiple exposures of the patient to the X-ray is done. Whereas in the cone beam CT, you just shoot, it is just like a panoramic radiographic X-ray. Just single shot you can take, and then you can evaluate the patient with this single shot, and that's why less time and less exposure of the patient. So the technique is economical again, because specifically when we are practicing in the country like India, which is developing, okay, so we have to keep in mind about the costing also, right from the medicinal treatment to the imaging. Okay, so the advantages of the CBCT, in just short I will just highlight. So low dose, which is always better for the humankind. Low equipment cost, so the low cost of imaging again. So multiplanar reconstruction images, MPR images, which we get are similar to that, with the geometric accuracy, similar to that of the CT scan. So you can get exact images of the bony pathologies. Okay, of course, bony pathology only. So no cupping artifact or streaking artifact. There are the blackening of the particular image when a restoration is there in the patient. So usually it is not seen in few patients, because nowadays software have been very well updated and upgraded. Okay. So, but the only limitation what I would like to discuss of the CT is the lack of user experience and a small body of literature few years back, which I had put down. But still we are in that phase, because many software gets upgraded, many software gets updated. Then we have literature again coming on day by day. Okay, so like less user experience, but once you get acquainted with CT scan machine, you will get more acquainted with the particular soft tissue contrast can be seen. But because of the Mars and very very beautiful software available in the market, you can even highlight the polypoid growth or the thickened sinus lining again into the sinus, what I have reported till date. Okay, so something we talk about the factualities, because without fact, without actual proof we cannot proceed in the medicinal field. Okay, so evidence based dentistry and evidence based medicine, EBD and EBM, everyone believe unless and until you show them the proof. Okay, so this is the 52-year male patient which was reported in my PG days. So you can see the comparative analysis of CBCT versus the conventional radiograph. So the overlapping signs, the alteration in the symmetry, Delbalso sign, etc., so on and so forth, we keep in mind. So the fracture fragment, site, orientation of the lines, and the comminution of the fracture can be very precisely seen. So I will not move the cursor, because the arrows itself are self-explanatory. Okay. This is the second patient of panfacial trauma, a 41-year male patient, again reported in our OPD. So it was operated by Department of Oral Surgery in SPDC, Wardha. Long back they were. So this was my study carried out. So you can see the multiple signs of the fracture in the conventional, but you cannot highlight because of the superimposition of the midface. Okay, midface you cannot highlight. So even if you take the panoramic and PNS, PA, there is always and always superimposition. So you cannot get the orientation or the depth, the depressed fracture or elevated one, only for the clinical radiography. So in this image, which is on the right, is a CBCT image. You can see the multiple comminuted fractures from the frontal bone to the mandible. Okay, the arrows indicate the fracture lines, fragments again. With respect to the multiplanar reconstruction of the same patient, you can see the coronal section showed the fracture, comminuted fracture of the condylar head in the three pieces. I can tell you the three pieces. So this is the bone of our three-dimensional imaging. Then next is the frontal bone fracture, discontinuity of frontal bone, and the sinus can be seen. Then left maxillary sinus, anterior posterior wall is fractured. There is a discontinuity again, you can see very precisely. So this is another patient with 53-year male having lipoid 1 and 2 on the right and the left side respectively. So how precisely the lines and the fracture lines and the fragment are visualized without any superimposition. So another 52-year male patient with a severity of zygomatic arch fracture, precisely zygomatic arch. You can see the comparative analysis, again the signs of the fracture, radiographic signs of the fracture, signs, orientation and the comminution of the fracture can be evaluated in this zygomatic arch and complex fracture. Not only this, but when we have taken the patient's three-dimensional imaging post-operatively, the software in that CBCT machine has highlighted the orbital mesh, which was placed by the oral surgeons on the floor of the orbit. Can anyone appreciate it? I'll just ask in the description later. The reconstruction plates on the lateral wall of the orbit, floor, zygomatic arch, maxilla, mandible, and arches and the wirings are so precisely evaluated that there is no query of that your diagnosis, your treatment plan is weird or your treatment plan is altered. Okay, so this is the reconstruction, the 3D image reconstruction again on the right side. So this is the again for mandibular condylar fractures, symphysis and bilateral condylar fractures. When we evaluated this patient for OPG, you can see the overlapping signs and you cannot make it very precisely where the direction of the fracture goes, because the lateral pterygoid pulls medially, superiorly, it might depress inferiorly again. So to overcome this, you can see the floating condyle in the three-dimensional CBCT image. You can make the appreciate because of the arrows. I will not go into that deep because it is a self-explanatory image according to me. So the 2D image X-ray of the CBCT, again, this is the software which can highlight the simple wiring on the right side. To the left side, you can see the arch wires and the ligature wire again. Okay. So again, same thing. So this was about the CBCT in maxillofacial trauma, and the two images which also can be considered imaging modalities like MRI and USG. I'll just go into the short because very few time when soft tissue injuries are done are occurring in the bone in the maxillofacial region, you can advise this MRI and USG. But how it has it is boon for our imaging imagology, I'll just describe. So coming to the discovery and history. It was discovered in 1977, which is a non-invasive test and gives the three-dimensional and non-ionizing radiation it uses. So it is very safe for the young patient, mostly with soft tissue injury expected by the surgeon or the physician. Okay. So it uses a powerful magnetic field, so does not have any radiation, what I had discussed previously. So indications, again, it is usually indicated in soft tissue injury, evaluation for the marrow space of TM joint, and which is in the condyle, and a articular disc specifically, which may get injured in the fractured condylar patients. So this is the image. I have not gone across any of the patients. These were the downloaded images, frankly speaking. So there is an orbital blowout fracture, blowing fracture, so on and so forth. I will not go into that depth again. See the orbit, the symmetry of the orbit is altered in the right side of the orbit with the arrow I have shown. The orbital blowout fracture, you can see the orbit now, it has expulsed from the orbital cavity. Okay, there are some muscles attached to the recti muscles, attached to the lateral rectus, medial rectus, and the eyeball. I'm just highlighting this. The mesial septum can be seen, but is usually not. And this is the brain tissue, grayscale matter. Okay, so both the things we can see, there are T1, T2 weighted images, but that is the technical part. I will not go into that detail because today's lecture is purely for the clinico-radiographic correlation. So this was the soft tissue injuries and discal injuries can be evaluated by the MRI alone. Coming to the last part of the lecture, USG. So how many of us might have think how the USG can help, because why I have included these, because even if we are working in the setup or PHC at a center in the town level or village level, where there is no setup like CT scan and patient is reported to you with the isolated ZM complex fracture, you are suspecting clinically without head injury. You are suspecting superficial fractures like midface fractures, like zygomatic arch fractures, mandibular symphysis, angle, condylar fractures. So you can just evaluate by using the probe. So there was a, coming to the in-depth knowledge of the USG in short, USG, it is a quick non-invasive diagnostic imaging modality, again, for evaluating the soft tissue pathology. But odd et al. Has evaluated a breakthrough in the orbital fracture, like that is the ream, the outer canthus of the line, frontal bone, etc., which are superficial bone. it cannot give the in-depth depth fracture like nasoid model fracture, which is at the near the midline, because the USG, the sonologic rays which will not pass through the bony structure and will not highlight the deeper part. It will pass only through the sono USG rays can only pass through the soft tissue structure only. So the bone which are over the which are on the superficial face. So this, the study of zygomatic arch, isolated zygomatic arch fracture was carried out by one of my colleague from Chennai and professor one of from Chennai ODMR department. So they carried out the isolated zygomatic fracture can be highlighted by using this USG alone. So you can see the left zygomatic and the right zygomatic arch, the role of the, you can see the separation sign, the bridge in the continuity of the zygomatic arch on the right side, whereas the zygomatic arch is a arch shape, bow shape on the left zygomatic. So they compared the USG. So it can be used for isolated fracture and associated with the minimal degree of swelling and tenderness, if it is or if at all there to the patient. So if at the setup, if you don't have CT scan or patient may not be affordable and you are suspecting at particular this, for the beneficial of the patient and treatment to be carried out, you can advise USG also. But the CT scan, CBCT remains the gold standard. So this is a cropped image, one of the article of the same I had shown. The conventional radiograph show the depressed sign, comminuted sign of the zygomatic arch fracture. This is a crop computed tomography axial image. You can see the M-shape sign. And then again, you can see the USG evaluation of the fracture fragment 1, 2, and 3. So the again, depressed fracture signs and separation signs can be evaluated very nicely. So coming to the concluding part of my lecture, the overall management of the patients with maxillofacial traumatic injury has been considerably influenced by our advanced imaging in radiology, and since last 4 decades we have advanced very vigorously. So it is very beneficial to the patient as well as the surgeons operating. So CT has supplanted but non-tomographic radiograph has no superimposition and of the radiopaque structures in the midface, specifically in the midface and the condylar head, vertical fracture of the head can be evaluated. Okay, so CBCT is also a boon because it provides the lower dose, lower cost multiplanar reconstruction images, 2D as well as 3D images in the geometric accuracy, and which can serve as a alternative to CT only if the patient is not having head injury. This is main line of the traumatic injury of the imageology principle for the traumatic injury, and when you indicate which radiographic imaging modality you indicate. So this was the study by Michowski's et al. In 2008. They compared the CT versus CBCT, and statistical significant difference between DVT and CT was not found. So they find the images expressing similarly in the reformatted images also have same diagnostic accuracy. So USG and MRI are also non-invasive, non-ionizing radiation techniques and can be used to evaluate the soft tissue and superficial injuries again. So this cutting-edge technology is thus an ideal imaging technique, not only for maxillofacial traumatic injuries, but in the pathologies which are affecting the patients with respect to the congenital like cleft lip, implant, dentistry, periodontal surgery, TM joint, orthodontic examination, and pathology, other pathology like cyst, tumors affecting the maxillofacial region. So I would like to conclude my lecture by showing the few images. When radiologists take selfie, the selfie contest also have been organized in our college. So this is the selfie of radiologists. So and finally, and last but not the least, I would like to thank to all my teachers and thank you all to those who have taught me, to my patient also those who have taught me, and library staff, those who have provided me with the connectivity, best connectivity for which I'm not lagging. So COVID message, stay home, stay safe and maintain social distancing. So my take home message again. So a special thanks to AOMSI Maharashtra chapter for giving me this opportunity to share my experience. Dr. Srinivas sir, Vice Dean and Head of the Department, and all the staff, Kulte ma'am, Shidhi sir, Pranav sir, and Nilima, moderator of course, and Department of OS, BSPM Dental College. I extend my thanks and gratitude to Dr. Mukta Motwani, my guide and professor in our department, BSPM Dental College, and also to Phoenix Imaging Center. Thank you, audience, for this patience listening. Hope I have not consumed more time or I'm in the mark of the time, and please don't ask, hesitate to ask the question on my email, on my call, etc. I am always available 24/7 on the email and call. So to better understand the pathology, we have better choices and we have best imaging modalities. 3D imaging is a boon for our medical fraternity. So we can work in future also in collaboration with these images. Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much. Yeah, please.
Thank you, Anurag.
Yes. Thank you, sir.
Nilima, are there questions?
Yes, sir. There are questions. Anurag, it was very nice presentation and up to the mark. There's one question from Dr. Saurabh Srivastav. He wants to know how can the newer technologies overcome the artifacts which are produced in post-operative CBCT images?
Yes, very nice question. Already I have described in the images of the patient. So nowadays the Mars software is there, metal artifact resolution software, which is available in CBCT, sir. Nowadays, newer machine which has come with the technology. It is a software part which is incorporated into the machine. So you can take these images with, they give you the one image, what is called a scout image, so that your image is appropriate or not, with minimum exposure of the patient, like what I have shown in the orbital mesh image. That is a scout image, the pre-image before shooting. You can see with that software, it can be incorporated into the CBCT machine, and CT machine also have upgraded themselves. So you can reduce that software again, sir, by minimum artifacts, post-operative plates. So it can be evaluated, sir, in the recent CBCT machines.
Yeah, by the software. Right. Yeah, there's another question from Dr. Jignesh. He's asking that, could you please elaborate on nerve mapping procedure once again?
Okay, so for that, I have to just carry out a workshop in implant imaging, basically. So what happens when the fracture of the mandible comes to us, the patient comes to any radiologist, in fact. So you have to see whether the vital structures are coming in the line of the fracture or not. Okay. And the vital structure are present in that, whether the tooth fracture is not. So when we have to scroll that image, when the patient image is open into the CD, we have to scroll that image and take the particular plane. We guide the plane and from the midline. So when you scroll that image, we get a uniform route of the mandibular canal. And then there is a software which gives the pinpoint access to the particular canal. I cannot show you in the imaginary way, but when you come to my center or when I'm just showing you the live presentation on the CD on my laptop, I'll show you how that nerve tracing is there. So you select that point, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, numbering of the point of the canal and give. And then when you double click that, that all points get joined by the software. So you can trace out the mandibular canal in the particular plane, okay, in that panoramic image, what I have shown in that reference panoramic, CBCT or CT, okay. Multiplanar reconstruction images is possible, okay.
Nilima, before you ask the next question,
yes, sir.
I wish to acknowledge the presence of Dr. Mukta Motwani, Professor and Head Department of ODMR.
Yes, sir.
The entire staff of ODMR is there. Dr. Ranpise was there. Dr. Pawan Modgare, a lot of people have joined. Anurag, for your lecture. Do forgive me if I don't name all of them, but thank you so much for joining. Mukta, can you say something?
Yeah, thank you so much. Nice presentation. First of all, I would like to congratulate Anurag for such a nice presentation. 1 minute, huh? Yeah, Anurag has been my PG student. And his interest in CBCT was long back, in 2008-09 when he was doing his PG. In fact, we didn't have a CBCT in our department. So he went all the way to interventional radiology and found that there is a machine there. And he did a study right at that time. So you can understand how much interest he has in this and how much he has improved on it and worked on it to be now a very good speaker. Even at state and sometimes national level also is giving lectures. So I congratulate this. One more thing I would like to emphasize is that although yes, CBCT is the magic, like a magic wand for radiology, but we have to be very careful in when and where we are advising it. So just that much, that's all. Thank you so much. And thank very you. Nice presentation.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Anurag, can you just stop sharing?
Yes, it stops. Yeah.
Can I ask question?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, please.
Anurag, this is a very good presentation you have done.
Thank you, ma'am.
I would like to ask you, how do we go for the volume measurement, orbital volume measurement, to know the increased volume for taking the decision of reconstruction of the orbital floor fracture?
Yes, ma'am. For this, I would like to add, we can take a volumetric representation. There are certain windows in the CT as well as CBCT. We have a bone window. We have a particular shapes and size. What you present in the PPT, ma'am. When we make a PPT, you have a various shapes. When you extend that shape, you can add a particular area into that. So when image of the patient is there, you just select that software option from that, and you select the particular orbit or the structure. When you select that particular orbital structure in that software, you will get a complete volume. For example, we have carried out the CT scan, CBCT thesis of the patient with sinus volume. So you just drag that cursor and you select that particular area of maxillary sinus, you will get a volume automatically, which area is selected from that. Okay, so the software also can be incorporated, ma'am, separately, but it may cost you some few thousands or lakhs. I think it may be evaluated, but for that CT will be the best, because CBCT comes in different field of view, ma'am. Different sensors are there, so 12 by 9, it will come in 17 by 13, or if you image that with a particular volume, so it can be evaluated by CT and MRI basically, ma'am. So CBCT will have a limitation over this, but still software is available for evaluating the volumes of the particular structures. Can be done, ma'am. The options are there.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Very well explained, Anurag. There's one off-bit question here. Do you have any experience regarding use of ultrasonography in patients with maggots?
Maggots usually, they are very soft tissues, like means soft form of that. The structure is very soft, so I haven't found till now regarding UHG. I haven't searched also,
right?
But I'll just try out and search it. But mostly it will not be used to that mark, UHG.
Right. There's one question. Which imaging tool is best for the diagnosis of extraocular muscle entrapment in orbital floor fracture?
Basically the soft tissue and soft tissue, whenever comes in our mind, the imaging modalities, MRI stands fit, perfectly fit for the volume, site, size, extent of the muscle entrap. Okay, but what happens nowadays, the gold standard forms to be CT. Why? Because it has three windows. It has a bone window which highlights only the bony tissue. It has intermediate window which highlights both bone as well as the soft tissue, like muscles and skin, and facial tissues. And it has a soft tissue window which highlights only the soft tissue. So both CT and MRI, I would like to give both equal points, but most widely used when you talk about is the CT in the soft tissue window, can be highlighted to give the volume of the muscle which is entrapped.
Right. Okay. There's another question. On what basis you decide slice intervals in CT scan?
Okay. That in the markets, in the marketed area, when you see the CT scan center and all, you see 32 slices CT, 64 slices CT, right. 128 slices. These are nothing but a multiple array of detectors, number of detectors. So more and more detectors are incorporated into the gantry. Okay, so you get more precise and resolution of the image is very nice when you see that. So higher nowadays, 128 slice, 256 slice CT scan, MDCT, multiple detector CT. They are the number of detectors when you see, when talk about in the slices of the CT.
Yeah, okay. There's one last question from my side. Dr. Zui wants to know, what is bright light sign in coronal CT section?
Bright light, it might be the artifacts, bright light, like streaking artifact, what we call about. there are two artifacts which come into the city when it strikes, when it gets attenuated with the hard object like restoration, crown or any plates. So when there is attenuation of the rays, okay, the rays get divergent, okay, or their rays get scattered, okay, that is captured by the series of detectors. So they are called as streak artifacts, which are white streaks coming out of the, because of the scattered rays. And there is called as cupping artifact, which is nothing but a dark shadow near the restoration or metal artifact. So these are the two artifacts. This might, that's rays, what you call it as, that might be the streak artifact and cupping artifact in our radiological terms. So this was my domain, so I can explain it in this way. So that might be the your questions, the resolution of the questions answer.
Okay, that was very nice presentation, Dr. Anurag. I think all questions have been taken. Sir, I'm done with questions.
Yeah.
If you have any questions with you.
I also would like to put on record our sincere thanks to Phoenix Dental Imaging, who have been kind enough to sponsor our series. Thank you so much to the promoters of Phoenix. And this is tomorrow's event. Dr. Kshitij is going to speak on zygomatico maxillary complex fractures. So do tune in at 11 o'clock. And I would now ask Abhilasha, before we present, do this presentation of certificates, I would like Abhilasha to kindly share the screen.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Anurag, wonderful presentation.
Thank you. Thank you.
So this is our webinar team who has nurtured our webinars to an adult now. From the initial hiccups we had, now we have that this was the 21st one. So Anurag, thank you. You made it the 21st one. And absolutely, I mean, I really was impressed by your talk. So great show. We also have a great thing coming up from 5th onwards. And Abhilasha? Yes. So this is something that possibly has never been done before. We're going to have an exclusive ladies week. So it will be by the ladies, of the ladies. And of course, it is for everyone. It is not for ladies. It is for everyone. These are people, these are divas of maxillofacial surgery who have taken maxillofacial surgery to its zenith. They are accomplished surgeons. So we'll be having a wide spectrum of speakers. And of course, the one you see in the center is Dr. Neelam Andrade, who is the Dean of Nair Hospital Dental College. And she's got a huge, huge responsibility of being the Dean of NESCO facility for COVID patients. So do join us from 5th onwards. The schedule will be put up very soon, right? Is there a question?
Hearing, sir.
So thank you so much. Abhilasha, thank you. So Anurag, on yes, behalf sir. Of, and Anurag, by the way, it was Central India Academy of Maxillofacial Surgery. Yeah? So
Maharashtra chapter, sir.
Yeah, Maharashtra chapter. We are a part of Maharashtra chapter and the national chapter.
Yes,
yeah, they're over. So Anurag, this is what you get when you sing for your supper. So thank you.
Thank you.
We are living in COVID time, so everything is e-certification, right?
Yes, sir.
And yes. Nilima, this is for your wonderful lecture, and I'm going to see more of you in the days to come. And Nilima,
yes,
thank
sir.
You for a
thank
wonderful
you,
job, right?
Thank you, yes. sir.
And yeah, so thank you, attendees. Please visit our page, Central India Academy of Oral and Maxillofacial Surgery, where you'll get to know more details. We are live on YouTube also, so you can watch it. And thank you, everyone. God bless you all.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr.